Good evening, everybody. Welcome to the MS MedSLP Class of 2023 White Coat Ceremony. My name is Dr. Linda Spencer, and I'm a professor and the program director and chair of the MS MedSLP program. And I'm honored to serve as your MC this evening tonight as we recognize the dedication, intelligence, and work of this group of MS MedSLP students in our second White Coat Ceremony ever. This marks the tradition or the transition from didactic learning and internal clinical learning led by our faculty and to starting in just a few weeks, a year of clinical externships. And I want to say you all clean up very, very nicely. I'm still trying to figure out who some of you are. I want to begin by acknowledging the presence of our faculty, staff, and students. And during each interlude, I'll introduce you to a faculty or staff member so that you can meet the team who's guiding your students and kind of put a name to the face, hopefully, of the good things you've heard about us. First, we want to express our gratitude to all those who have organized this event, including Katie Sprouse, Event and Experience Coordinator. Where is Miss Katie? There she is. Thank you, Katie. And second, I want to express my gratitude to the administrative guests we have on stage, including Dr. Mark Horacek, Executive Vice President for Academic Affairs and Provost. You can wave, okay. Mr. Stephen White, Vice President of Communications, Marketing, and Enrollment. And Ms. Lori Sisk is not here, but she is the Assistant Vice President of Student Affairs. And finally, Dr. Richard P. Nielsen. He is the founding president and CEO of Rocky Mountain University of Health Professions. He earned his doctorate in health science with an emphasis in clinical electrophysiology from the University of St. Augustine in Florida. And Dr. Nielsen served in the United States for over 20 years, in the United States Navy for over 20 years, and he held several positions such as the physical therapy consultant to the Surgeon General and the White House. He is also affectionately known as Ranger to those who travel with him with World of Difference to Africa, which is a nonprofit agency that does service in Africa. So without further ado, Dr. Nielsen's going to address us this evening. Thank you, Dr. Nielsen. Dr. Nielsen.
It kind of sounded like an obituary there for a minute, didn't it? Hey, isn't this awesome? I guess I need to be formal and say Dr. Horacek, Mr. White, certainly Dr. Linda Spencer and the faculty, esteemed faculty and guests. Family members, loved ones, and friends of this most elite group of MSSLP, MSSLP students, cohort 5. This is an amazing experience, and I know that all of you here have come here in support of them because you have been in support of them all along, right? Not just since they started to come to Rocky Mountain University, but all along in their life. Because of your support, because of your interest in them, they sit here before us tonight or today. So thank you for all you've done to be that great source of strength and support and encouragement, and be the ones that believed in them, because here they are now at this very interesting transition point of their academic career. I also wanted to thank those who have helped Katie and others who have put this thing together. These are not easy things to put together. There's a lot of stuff, right, Katie? Yeah, you're still smiling. But thank you for all the work you've done. And I also really want to acknowledge all the faculty of the MedMSSLP program. You all know who I'm talking about. They're the ones that you you sup with, right? And you eat out of their hands, and you learn from their experiences and their ways. What would we do without all of the faculty? So I really want to reach out to them today. Mark Twain is somebody that I kind of like. I read a lot about him. And he said something about you. He said, education involves not only what you learn, but also what you unlearn about yourself, right? So this program has been a program so far that you have probably unlearned a whole lot about who you are, right? And you're replacing that by who you learned, who you're learning you are, you really are. And I want to tell the family and loved ones and friends and parents and others here that during their sojourn here so far, they have unlearned a whole lot. But I also promise you that they have learned a whole lot about who they are going to become and the impact and the effect that they're going to have on healthcare in this country, in this world, as they move forward. Now, this white coat ceremony is kind of a traditional thing. It's been going on at RMU for about 10, 12 years now. But even before that, we had ideas about that. But it's all over the world. The white coat is kind of a symbolic thing. It's actually more of a kind of a contract of sorts that you make with between you, your profession, your patients, and humanity, all right? So it's kind of a rite of passage, right? You're going from the didactic classroom environment to more of a clinical environment, even though I know that you have a kind of a mix of both all along. But it's a very traditional and a very important impasse, if you will. I mean, rite of passage for you at this time. And when you don tonight this white coat, you are essentially making a covenant, a promise, a contract, okay, in the following 9 ways, all right? Now, I could have 93 ways, and we'd be here until midnight, but it's only 9. I'm going to get through the list pretty fast. Number one, you are committing to yourself, to your patients, to your profession, and to humanity that you will be accountable for who you are inside the clinic and outside of the clinic. Number two, that you will practice effective and provide effective care to your patients. There's a lot of trends out there. There's a lot of fads in healthcare delivery. You're going to make sure you provide the most effective care to your patients. Patch Adams, remember Patch Adams? He said something about that. He said, you treat the disease, you win some, you lose some. You treat the person, you will always win. Regardless of the outcome, you will always win. So providing effective care to the person, not to the disease, okay? Number three, that you will demonstrate continuous integrity. Continuous integrity. Now, integrity is something that is kind of missing from society today. There's a lot of people that are doing things that don't have much integrity associated with it. You're not one of those. When you put on this white coat tonight, you make a promise to yourself, to your profession, to your patients, and to humanity that you will have integrity in everything you do, both inside and outside of the clinic. Lars Thorgensen said this about integrity. If you value integrity, then stand by to be beaten up by those who have none. Because the world today is full of people who do not have integrity. And you are a target to them if you do. So that's one of your promises that you're making to yourself. Number four, that you will have compassion and caring, not only to your patients, but for humanity in general. compassion, empathy. When we go to Africa, Dr. Spencer's been to Africa with us a few times. When we go to Africa, we learn about what the importance is of compassion and empathy, because that's the grassroots of healthcare, that you treat somebody because they need the help, not necessarily because of what you might make in process of that from a financial standpoint. So compassion and caring is something you promise to do when you put this white coat on today. The Dalai Lama said, if people want to be happy, they will practice compassion. If you want others to be happy, practice compassion. If you want to be happy, practice compassion. Number four, civility and kindness. Now, if you know anything about the culture of Rocky Mountain University, we have certain principles that make up who we are. Those principles are collaboration, communication, cooperation, integration, civility, kindness, integration, and fun. It's all part of our culture. Civility and kindness is something that you promise yourself, your profession, and your patients that you will uphold when you are donning this white jacket today. There's an old Japanese proverb that says, one kind word will warm three winter months. A kind word, civility, being nice to people. It's just being nice to people. Goes a long, long way in today's society, in today's world, and opens up many doors of opportunity for those of you who are. The next one, I don't even know what number we're on. Six, maybe? Five. Okay, thank you. Demonstrate excellence in all that you do. Now, you are above and beyond the ordinary. My mother used to raise me. I was raised as the youngest of four children by a single mother who had a ninth grade education. She didn't know anything about a lot of things, but she had a PhD, if you will, in wisdom. And she taught me a lot. And a lot of what she taught me at her knee is why I'm here today. My mother used to always say, ordinary people wait for opportunities. Extraordinary people create them. My mother taught me how to be extraordinary in everything I do, whether it's on the field, the athletic field, the football, the basketball court, whether it's in the academic world or being a neighbor to my next door neighbor who's in need. Be extraordinary. Don't satisfy yourselves with being ordinary. When you put this when you don this white jacket today, you promise yourself, your patients, your profession, that you're going to do everything you can to be extraordinary. And do you know what? Today, without integrity and the things we've talked about, being extraordinary is an amazing thing. Number seven. Six. Okay, number six. Number six has to do with being lifelong, being a lifelong learner. That you will commit yourself to being a lifelong learner. It's not about getting out of this program and then going into your practice and never reading another article, never attending another professional conference, never reading a book, or even talking about stuff with one of your colleagues. Being a lifelong learner is very, very important, not just in your clinical skills, but in life in general. How to become a better person. At Rocky Mountain University, we have a couple of platforms that while you're here as a student, you may not even know this, that you can tap into. One is called Percipio. It's a platform, a learning platform. And the other one is LinkedIn Learning, that you can learn anything you want to learn about any subject you want to learn about. And it's done on our dime and our time, meaning you don't have to pay for it. And you don't have to do it outside of the, you know, if you can do it while you're even in class or you know, taking a break or whatever you might do, you can learn some of these things in a 5-minute video that's available to you. So becoming a lifelong learner. Next is altruism. Now, the definition of altruism is that you're going to put the interests of other people, not just your patients, everybody, above and ahead before your own interests. It's called selflessness. You put the interests of other people before your own. As healthcare providers, we have to do that. And it's not just to our patients. It's to our neighbors. It's to our family members. It's to those who are strangers to us, those who cross our paths, and those who maybe find themselves planted in our paths. Altruism is about service, selfless service. My wife and I have a mantra that we live by. We've been living it by ever since we've been married. And we say that it goes like this. It says, you don't have to go out of your way to serve somebody. You just simply do it on your way. Altruism is looking at ways that you can serve somebody on your way, putting their interests before your own. To the world, you may be just one person. But to one person, you may be the world. You just don't know. You just don't know who was waiting for you to be able to serve that day. And finally, be generous. Be generous in everything you do. Be kind, be civil, you see the theme here? Okay, be generous in all that you do, to the point where generosity becomes part of your character. Generosity becomes part of who others see you to be. And generosity is demonstrated by the impact you're having on the world. There's a lot of responsibility putting this jacket on, right? Some of you are saying, I don't know if I ought to put that on or not. Okay, we grow into those things, right? So I congratulate you for making this step, getting to this stage. We'll be seeing more of you. You're not going anywhere. You are, but we'll still see more of you. I want to close with a favorite quote of mine. In case you don't know, I like quotes. and this one is, everybody sitting behind me has probably heard this so much, but they never get sick of it because they haven't learned it yet, right, maybe? It's from Da Vinci in 1490. He was born a couple years before I was. All right? And Da Vinci said this about you. He said, it has long since come to my attention that people of accomplishment... It has long since come to my attention that people of accomplishment rarely sat back and waited for things to happen to them. Rather, they went out and happened to things. So your charge is to go out and happen to things. Happen to your family. Happen to your communities. Happen to your next door neighbors. Happen to those people on the street that you meet for the first time. Happen to the world and humanity. And remember, on this thing here you see, this pin, you see our tagline, which is advancing knowledge, advancing healthcare, right? We're doing everything we can. It's a promise to you that we're going to do everything we can to advance your knowledge of the med SLP industry. And then the second part of that is that we depend on you then to go forward and advance healthcare. That's what you're going to be doing now when you're wearing this white coat, as you're going to go out now and start advancing healthcare. Make a difference. Don't ever give up an opportunity to continue to train your hands and to open your minds and to enlarge your hearts. That's the secret to success, secret sauce of success in healthcare. I leave that with you, with the blessings of all of the administration of this institution and in gratitude for all that you have done and will do now as you go forward. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Nielsen. It's always a privilege and an honor to listen to your wise words. So this evening, you're going to hear from a student speaker who was selected by the class and a faculty member who was selected by the class. And our class, and it just so happens that one of the speakers is a class co-president, and then the other student you'll hear from is her partner, her co-president as well. So that's what's coming up. But before we hear from our student guest speaker, I just want to introduce you to some of our faculty members. Now, we have quite a few people missing tonight, so I'm going to tell you who they are. But there are several people we won't have a face to show you tonight. So I first want to talk about Miss Elby Stonier. She is probably on the highway right now. She was trying to make it back from a week of camping with girls, and I don't know what happened to her. We know we'll see her at some point, but she must not have made it back. But Ms. Stonier's expertise is in pediatrics and pediatric feeding. She came to us Utah from Idaho. And so she has been somebody that the students have all worked with quite a bit. Then my next person I'll introduce is Dr. Stockdale. If you could just kind of stand up or wave over there. Dr. Stockdale's area of expertise is swallowing disorders and aphasia. He came to us by way of Florida, and we are so fortunate to have him. So thank you, Dr. Stockdale. Now I'll introduce, and I'll just kind of trickle out different people at each interval. So now I want to introduce a student who was selected by the class to share some words of wisdom and encouragement. This is Ms. Delena Swan from San Antonio, Texas. Delena is, as I said, a co-president of this class. She obtained her bachelor's in communication disorders from the University of North Texas, if I'm correct there, with a minor in interdisciplinary studies in 2020. Delena was raised in London for most of her formative years, and she describes herself as a first-generation student of a mother from Ghana. Delena is known and beloved by her cohort for her earnest disposition, her positive attitude, and her playful spirit. That's a direct quote from one of your classmates. And according to another one of her classmates, I'm still learning to understand Delena's particular sense of humor. So without further ado, Delena.
Yes, so it was great to hear what my classmates have had to say. So I'd like to thank everyone that has traveled here from near and far. So welcome to Utah. Welcome back, or thank you for making the journey on I-15. I hope you appreciate the beauty of the mountains behind the inversion. This ceremony marks our transition to the outside world. Receiving these white coats proves that we are ready for our externships in the fall, wherever they may be. This is our rite of passage that recognizes all of our hard work that has led us up to this point. I am honored to receive this white coat along with my peers. We made it through the wilderness. Somehow we made it through. At this moment, we are now prepared to take the next step as practitioners. Coming to Rocky Mountain University of Health Professions was a complicated process. I know that some of my classmates can agree. From the moving process to transition to graduate school, it was a new beginning in a new state or a new program. We had to adapt to the challenges presented to us. We were entering a new world of professionalism and stress that many have undertaken before us. Being a MedSLP graduate student is a hard job. It's actually not a job, more like an unpaid internship with no dental. They say you'll never work a day in your life if you love what you do. Don't get me wrong, grad school is backbreaking work, but there is an abundance of joy when you give everything you can to help another human being. We were all drawn to this field for a magnitude of reasons, and we can all say that coming to this program has increased our knowledge and love for the field. As a student, we have been molded to reach new heights. Through every challenging moment, we have gained new knowledge that we will carry with us throughout our careers. We've had to tackle these challenges head on as we've been baptized through fire. We've taken a lap around the clinic and soaked in a future yet to come. Everything we have done is in preparation for our future selves. We're preparing them for a long and successful career in this field. This program has prepared us for all avenues of the future. This program has given us a unique opportunity to grow in our clinical journey by serving members of our community right here in Provo and all around Utah. We may not always wear our white coats, but I will always maintain my white coat energy. I'm so thankful for my time at RMU, as it would propel me into this fantastic field of MedSLP. Most importantly, I am eternally grateful for all my professors, supervisors, and all supporting faculty. The long hours and encouragement they have given me and all of us have created a space for us in this field. They've broken through barriers to allow all of us to be our most successful selves. I thank you for myself and my classmates. Though this is not a goodbye because we still have classes, just know that while we were at our externships, you may have facilitated our success and acclimated us to be the best clinicians we can possibly be. So thank you.
Thank you, Delana. Aren't you so glad I didn't tell that story about how when I looked up you were under your desk in class the other day?
Before we hear from our next speaker, I would like to mention that we are missing our beloved Dr. Priscilla Danielson, who is in Pennsylvania. She has been there this week. And our thoughts are with her. She lost her mother this week, so that's why she's not here. And she said she wanted to see pictures of all the jewelry that you're wearing, so please do take those pictures. And I want to introduce another one of our clinical professors, and that is Ms. Kristen Ipsen, who is here. She's a wounded bird. She had surgery on her hand yesterday, So you can wave your good hand if you want. Kristen came to us. She's one of our only faculty members who is really from Utah. She was born in Utah and educated here in Utah. Her area of expertise is early intervention, language, and literacy. So we are very pleased to have you here. And then I want to also introduce Dr. Phil Sectum. Can you just stand and wave? His area of expertise is neurological aspects of communication, voice, and swallowing disorders. And he has spent his summer teaching our students, along with another one of our students, to do both rigid and flexible endoscopy. And Dr. Sectum came to us by way of Kansas. So thank you. Our next speaker is Ms. Wendy Chase, who is the Director of Clinical Education here at Rocky Mountain University of Health Professions. Ms. Chase received the Rising Star Teaching Award, which is the highest award bestowed upon our faculty, who were in their first 5 years of teaching here at RMU. So we have a sign up in our mailroom that says, "We always knew you were a rising star." and that's very, very true. Ms. Chase earned her Bachelor's of Science at Central Michigan University and her Master's at Northwestern University. She has 30 years of experience in clinical positions treating clients from infancy through geriatrics and in locations from home care to hospitals. Ms. Chase was most recently employed as the Director of Clinical Education at the University of Connecticut, where her focus was on interprofessional education and practice and assessment of swallowing in clients with ventilator dependency. Ms. Chase believes that critical thinking and evidence-influenced practice are hallmarks of excellent speech-language pathologists, and she strives to support student acquisition of these core skills through quality clinical education. We're so grateful for her steady clinical leadership, and we look forward to hearing from her this evening. Ms. Chase.
Hello, everybody. You may soon regret that you have selected me to provide this lecture. Because we all know when I start a lecture, I can just keep going and going and going until Jamie tells me it's time for a break. So, Jamie, if you need to make a comment, you just go right ahead and do that. Okay. So when we were talking about this ceremony a couple of weeks ago, Ms. Herget over here said, you understand that the white coat has the same initials as Wendy Chase. And you could make a joke about that. And I said, well, I could, but we'd probably be the only ones that would laugh. So I'm going to skip that part. This isn't the Wendy Chase ceremony, much as I might like it to be. And we're going to talk more about what this white coat ceremony means for you. Okay? This is a particularly meaningful ceremony and a meaningful point in your career for reasons that we have already talked about. It is a transition. Okay? But for me, as the Director of Clinical Education and representative of your faculty, it represents your acquisition of the core competencies that you need to take you into an unknown clinical situation and succeed. Because you have learned the skills now that you can think your way through whatever may face you and find the resources you need, you are ready to make this transition. So let's talk a little bit about how we got here. Okay, so we spent the last three semesters together doing some things that would help you have these core competencies available to you. So the first was providing you with some foundational knowledge. Right? There are core things you need to understand about clients and disorders and so on, right? We also helped you choose materials and practices that were to the benefit of our evolving societal needs. So society keeps changing, which means what you do as a professional in this field will keep changing, and we want you to be aware of that. And we want you to recognize and embrace that as you are determining how to best meet your clients' needs going forward. We've also listened to employers. We've listened hard to the people that are out there working, saying, you know what, in the field these days, this is the stuff that these students need to be able to do. And we've tried really hard to inform our teaching from that perspective. So that when you go, you can be, as President Nielsen says, the people that change healthcare. Okay? The people that change what's happening. You have that ability now, and you get to start practicing it over the next three semesters. So a couple of other things that we've done, we've designed some activities, some trainings, some simulations, validations, and so on that require you to apply this foundational material in some of these core thinking practices. Okay, so we've tried to give you at least a brief glimpse of what may be coming. We've asked you to work with one another towards a common outcome, and that's not easy. We've asked you to improve your communication with team members and with your faculty so that it supports the kind of conversations you need to have as professionals in a workplace in order to best care for your patients. We've asked you to bring your perspective to the problems that we discuss and the cases that we engage with, because you all have different ones. And the more ways we look at a problem, the more perspectives we take, the better we understand what can happen going forward. You have had the responsibility of broadening one another's minds and ours as you consider how other people see things. We've placed you in clinical activities that required a pretty wide variety of skills. Some that meant that you had to develop lessons that met the needs of people that scared you or intimidated you or made you feel silly instead of therapeutic. Okay? We've had you develop lessons that met the needs of people in a group, even when they didn't all have the same problem. That's not easy, but you've worked through it. We've asked you to figure out what a child was really communicating when all they were saying was, I don't want to do all those activities you selected for me today. There's nothing on your lesson plan I'm interested in, thank you very much. What's really going on here? We asked you to look below the surface and figure out what was going on that you could affect a change with. We asked you to adapt to a whole mess of different supervisory styles and tendencies and requirements, and you hated that. And we made you do it anyway, because we're all unique, just like you are, and you will have to work with a wide variety of personalities and styles, and resilience and adaptability matter. We asked you to practice your role as a counselor and a person who supports, encourages, and empathizes with your clients to allow them safe spaces to communicate in. And you have wildly exceeded expectations in that category. Our clinic provides you with lots of options on that one to practice your counseling skills. And we are so impressed regularly with the maturity and the professionalism that you demonstrate in respecting your clients and what they're going through. So during all of these experiences, we have very slowly, well, we thought it was slowly, you might have thought it was very abrupt, but removed the support that we were giving you on a minute-to-minute basis until we got to this semester, where the majority of what we are emphasizing is your ability to reflect. We introduced you to clinical reflection. We asked you to search your reflections for the evidence of clinical skills that were needed, those you demonstrated and those you need to work on. We asked you to develop goals for yourself related to that. We asked you to advocate for what you need from your support personnel. That would be us, okay, in order to achieve those clinical goals. And we've asked you to engage in clinical inquiry. Clinical inquiry for the purpose of your own competence. And that has been a concept that's taken us a good 3 semesters to really ingrain. But I think you got it now. You have to look at that case and you have to determine what you need to learn to be competent to take care of that individual and provide them with the best service. And again, so well done on your part, getting to the point where you can say, I need to learn a little more about this if I'm going to do this well. I need to go search for this. I need to get some help from somebody else. Okay? And those are some things that are just critical to your ability now to succeed on a whole different level in your external placements. So, personally, there are some things that we've experienced together over the last 3 semesters that I want you to reflect upon and hopefully see, despite the moment that they occurred, probably feeling not that fun, were meant to help you move along in the process of clinical education. So I've challenged you to think deeper. No matter what you said, it wasn't ever deep enough for a while there. I've challenged you to think more expansively about a problem, that there are more than one way to solve things. There is more than one way to solve things. I've pleaded with you to care more about just the speech and language problem that your client demonstrates, and to think about the implications of all of the other parts of that human when you're designing the care that you will deliver. And let's face it, I spent a good considerable amount of time increasing your anxiety and probable consumption of unhealthy food choices. A strategy, by the way, I wholeheartedly embrace. We have shared tears, we have shared frustration, we have shared laps around the clinic. Okay, we didn't share that, I told you to do it because you were driving me crazy. Just so that all of your families know, teaching you at 8 o'clock in the middle of a week at night, not an easy job. Sometimes we just need to get up and move. And we have done all of these things together because we care deeply about this profession, which means we have to care deeply about you. You are the ones that carry this profession forward. You are the ones that let the public see the power and the benefit of this field. We care. We care a lot so that you will go forward and care a lot. And now we know, and you know, it's critical for you to accept the responsibility of providing exceptional care to your clients. After all the crying and the laughing and the learning and the falling and the soaring and the infection control and the professionalism and the chipping away and the critical thinking, we have tried to encourage the behaviors that will help you to be the best that you can be, and then by your hand, the patients you treat to be the best selves that they can be. Let's talk real quickly about your cohort in particular. Cohort 5. So every cohort has a personality all of its own, and we've talked about that. Cohort 5 has been deemed the quiet one. Now, there are a handful of exceptions to that, but in general, your cohort is the quiet one. As a group, you've been a little more subdued in class discussion, some of the activities, et cetera, than some other cohorts have been. But what does that quietness really contain? What does that quietness cover? For me, I see it hiding perseverance. Quiet perseverance, because you just keep going. And that's not easy. I see it as hiding quiet resilience, even when you don't wanna. I see it hiding quiet emerging reflection. I see it hiding quiet empathy. And I see these things because you have cared for my clients in a way that I respect. You have made it clear that you care for my clients. Your quiet skills of integration, knowledge building, and competence, along with acceptance of others and situations, is what make you the best quiet advocate we can send out there. You will succeed. You will succeed in your placements by relying on those quiet qualities. They are your superpower, along with what else? Your speech brain. Correct. So here we are, your faculty up here hoping and wanting and expecting and anticipating your success, but knowing that it is now up to you to make that happen. Keep doing it. Keep doing the reflecting and the integrating and the thinking, and you will be the best cohort so far. Thank you.
Okay, now this is the moment. As we prepare to bestow the white coats, I'm going to introduce Ms. Sasha Herget, who is our internal RMU Center for Communication Disorders Clinic Coordinator and our departmental administrative assistant. As we go, she's going to be calling out the names. Ms. Sasha is someone all of our students rely on to help them transition into that internal clinical aspects of all the program. So she'll be reading the names as we go forward. Ms. Sasha.
And as we get set up, would you please offer some applause to Dr. Spencer? Norma Ayala. Yasmin Campos. Aaron Christensen. Tiare Coker. Jamie Darling. Stephanie Duran. Emily Garrett. Yeah.
Reagan Gibson. Tiffany Amber Greenfield. Shelby Haig. Courtney Cushing Hale. Katie Hall. Cindy Hart. Stephanie Incandela. Alexa Ireland. Rebecca Jones. Terry Kawasaki. Lauren Lenker. Yeah. Cassandra Martin. Alyssa Catherine McDaniel. Maria Oida. Melissa Powell. Amora Pratt. Michelle Reyes. Allison Janelle Romero. Celine Skibicki. Amanda Smith. Macy Smith. Sullivan. Delina Swan. Kimberly Tran. Eunice Catherine Valverde. And Michaela Womack. One final round of applause for our 2022 MedSLP White Coat recipients.
Now I will turn the program over to our other co-president, who is co-president of the class of 2023, Aaron Sullivan, who came to us from the University of Iowa. Go Hawkeyes! And she hails from Illinois. Erin, you will come up and read the oath.
Okay. Hello, everyone. Before we recite the oath, I want to thank all of our families, our friends, faculty, and everyone who has supported us so far. We would not be here without you. Now I invite cohort 5 to stand. Raise your right hand and repeat after me. As I begin my clinical service, I dedicate myself to promote, the autonomy of my patients, To serve with beneficence,
to act in their best interest,
and to assure they will benefit
from my care and treatment.
I will strive for justice
in access to treatment
to preserve the dignity and confidentiality of those I serve. And to communicate.
With my patients and their loved ones.
With honesty and truth. As a speech language pathologist, I promise.
To work towards advancing science.
Setting standards. Fostering excellence in professional practice. And advocating for those I serve.
I vow to practice.
With integrity, humility.
Honesty and compassion.
Working with other healthcare professionals.
To provide the best possible care.
For my patients. You may be seated. Thank you.
Thank you, Erin. I want to let your family, friends, and loved ones of this class in on a secret about this group of individuals. Don't worry. As a faculty, we are very, very proud how they have persevered during this time of drought, pandemic, and overall uncertainty. They persevere and they do their best at every turn to assure that their patients receive the best of care. We are in good hands going forward. Thank you, everybody, and good evening. And there are treats outside the door. Oh, you know what? I am so sorry. I was supposed to read the class mission. Delana is reading it. Is that right?
Yes.
Okay. Delana? So sorry about that.
The mission of the Medical Speech Language Pathology Program is to encourage autonomy and passion amongst one another and make meaningful contributions to the field of speech language pathology. We strive to demonstrate competence within our scope of practice and educate others on our field service. We are dedicated to lifelong learning by engaging in reflective and collaborative practice. We aim to express our enthusiasm for patient care through holistic patient-centered therapy services. We seek to illuminate total communication and well-being of our patients by recognizing their diverse and individual needs. Finally, we subscribe to the belief that communication is a human right and commit ourselves to giving our patients the respect and priority that comes with this absolute.
Now we're done. Thank you so much, Delana. Is this an encore?
Yes. There was one note I was told to pass on, that we have to stock and fill our cups with knowledge and chase our dreams.
We get it. Thanks, everybody. Thank you again, and have a wonderful weekend.